Children of one Father, I greet you in the holy name of the preparatory vibration to your investiture with the grace of divine Christhood. For the world waits for the dawn, for the renaissance of our love. And our love is overwhelmingly made manifest to each of you according to your faith. I, Maitreya, come to you this night in God's holy name to kindle and to quicken your consciousness and the vibratory action thereof, that you may be a new creature in Christ, in the consciousness and awareness of who and what you are. We have called you forth out of the land of bondage, out of the darkness into the light. And beloved hearts, what we long to see manifest in all of the student body, those who are devoted to the unfailing light of the Christ, is an increase and step up in the level of the radiance of your own God presence as it manifests already in your world, but now more fully as you admit it into the sacred precinct of your own God-centered will. We say, let the will stand forth and devote itself upon the altar of fealty to the perfection of your God presence and to the great cosmic release of that ineffable light which your own beloved I Am presence is manifesting both now and always, because you are the light in the eye of God. You are a blessed part of cosmos, of the creative manifestation of universal perfection. When you call forth your perfection, do so with the authority of Almighty God. For who shall act for you if not yourself, your true self, that portion of divine manhood which is wholly devoted to the release of the perfection of your presence in your own practical daily life. Beloved ones, when you pray, give us this day our daily bread, is it not because you expect that daily bread to be made manifest? Well then, is it not time for each one to recognize at last that the cosmic hour has struck, that all mankind should come into such sweet consonance and perfection as to make them truly brothers in manifestation? What is it in the world, save Antichrist, that causes brother to sever connection with brother and spreads abroad in the world the shroud of separation and darkness? What is it that draws mankind into the universal magnet of cosmic harmony but your own God presence? The magnet of your presence is manifest here now. I speak to you as a father. I speak to you as a brother. I speak to you as one who has gone on before, but who is with you still, because the flame of your true cosmic identity is ablaze within the center of your being. And because that flame is there, I am there also, as is every other ascended being and the universal embodiment of the perfection of the whole God panoply of manifestation. All are there in the chambers and the recesses of your heart. Those beautiful, vaulted regions where the power of expansion dwells. Do you not know that the temple of your heart is the doorway to the love of God, that the great love ray in manifestation literally pours forth to inundate the entire world with that indwelling love for the universal Christ, which will change the face and complexion of mankind until they wear upon their face, as within their heart, the smile of God, a smile that is as the smile upon the face of a little child who is willing to walk through the darkness and tremble not, for he knows that on the other side of the darkness of this current region of infamy, which mankind calls temporary life, he will find, if he be constant to his trust, which God has placed in him, as God is also constant to his trust, which some men have believed in God. Then you see on the other side the beautiful light that shall never be extinguished, shall manifest not only for yourselves, but for all mankind. And what a bonanza, what a gift of cosmic love, when humanity are gathered together, the entire family of nations, under one divine regent, under the living omnipresence of the Son of God. The time is now when mankind must commence the gathering together for a cosmic purpose. And when we come together with you, as we are now doing, it is not alone that we come, for we come also with myriad hosts of angelic beings, and we come also with the great hosts of heaven, the ascended master's consciousness, to renovate your hearts, to create a renaissance of hearts, that men may once again realize the power of cosmic vision. What is cosmic vision if it is not the ability to perceive? And it is by your new perceptions of your new reality, of your new investiture, which the universe has made in you, that you will begin to perceive at last that you are a new creature in Christ, one who is no longer like unto his former self, being changed from glory unto glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. For the cosmic truth that is with you is the omnipresence of God. It comes into your heart as though it were a tiny babe. And then it begins the expansion process. For God within you grows within you. God matures within you as you grow up in the understanding of the compassion of your presence for every part of life. Life is one, and when men are admitted to the sacred precincts of the Great White Brotherhood, when they come into that sacrosanct area, the holy ground upon which we tread, they will be a different person. For the vibratory quality of the sacred law, of the sacred fire, which is within your heart now ablaze, will lead you and guide you across the desert sands, the emptiness of life, the failures in life, and the weaknesses of life, to the time of your greatest strength, the time of a new beginning, the time of the dawn, the time when the Son of the Eternal Presence comes up with the thunder of God to make you aware of the newness of life in a new and living way. Why is it, beloved ones, that men and women created in His image, endowed with His power and His ability, are so prone to allow themselves to become pitiful creatures of happenstance and circumstance, learning from one another what is not the will of God or the wisdom of God, but what is in reality the corruption of the divine image? Do you think, beloved ones, that when you stand before me, when you are admitted to the holy mountain, and you stand before the great lords of karma, when you are admitted to our presence, that you will be able to hide those activities which you have performed that were not actually unity with God? I do not think so. So, dear hearts, recognize the need to be able to raise yourself now and to rid yourself of those unwanted qualities, those qualities of darkness and deceit, which are the hypocrisy of the present time. For contemporary man has often carried out in secret that which he would never do openly. And this has occurred also throughout the entire historical stream. We come then to you tonight to make you aware of the great panacea of the universal Christ I amity, the great power of universal forgiveness, the power that reaches out to the very point in your heart that is the altar stone of your heart, to place there that living flame which will impart to each one in the name of the living God the quality of infinite mercy and the forgiveness of sins. We are eager. God is eager. All of heaven is eager. The angelic hosts are ready, and they wait to bring to you the sweet oil of forgiveness that will change every thought in your life to a constructive one, that will change every quality of feeling in your feeling world into a feeling of divine and infinite devotion. Devotion is like a sweet oil. It is like a sweet incense. It rises before the face of God. It brings the flowers of devotion and the sacred white ash into manifestation in man, that he may understand that some in every age, if they would be faithful to the great cosmic truth, could be made ready for the ascension in that manner where their entire body would also ascend. We want you to understand that we have prepared the best gifts for you, that these are like the lightning that cometh out of the east and goeth unto the west. For the mounting crescendo of cosmic love that is the result of mankind's devotion for higher things may not appear in the world to be a reality. For many in the world today do not reveal their cosmic affiliations with our brotherhood. We find many of them that desire instead to maintain that anonymity, that quality of life which remains anonymous to all, that does not tell all that they know, that does not even in some cases tell one iota. And yet at the same time, blessed hearts, there are those that must speak the truth unto mankind. We say unto you that we love you all in whatsoever state you are in, for we do not see you as though you were deeply mired in those elements of human sin, but instead we see you raised to the great cosmic head of the universal Christhood, the universal spirit, that was manifest in Jesus. We see the crown of thorns which humanity still presses into the side of one another and into the head of the living Christ. They do this in ignorance, and we cry out today, as in days of old, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Let this be your cry also, and let it be a cry of mercy. Let forgiveness and love and mercy be unto all generations of them that fear me and love my name, God has said. And we who have become the embodiment of all that he is, we also echo and re-echo in the chambers of our mind and our heart those sacred words and that sacred feeling that is the great spirit of cosmic openness that goeth forth into the world, creating newness of life and opportunity for every child of God. For humanity today, in their era of darkness, are often suspicious, and they doubt the very powers of life that gave them birth. They do not understand how life today manifests. They do not understand what great pathos there is in the universe that is the spirit that spoke of old in the Master Jesus when he said, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often would I have gathered you together, even as a chicken gathers her young, and ye would not, oh, ye would not. The lamentations of the Spirit of God are the outcry in time itself against those ill deeds that are carried out by some men without understanding and without grace. The cosmic fires burn, the cosmic flame blazes, and the great grace of God is carried from the snow upon the mountains down to the cities of the plain, that all men may break this sacred bread in God's name, that they may understand his grace and his love as their own, that they may understand that his grace and love even today does atone for all that man has done, for all that man does. And yet we provide a new and a living way through his flesh, through the flesh that you wear. For in reality, you have also entered into the kingdom. The cosmic die is struck, and the divine image is perpetuated in yourself. Deeply within the chalice of your heart, you will find the replica of the God flame, as in the fiery furnace. When the Christ appeared with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, one like unto the Son of God, and they beheld him, and no smoke nor harm came unto them, and they emerged free and unscathed from the flame. So will mankind do today, if they will but understand the meaning and purpose of the perpetuation of the flame. For the meaning and perpetuation of the flame is so that man may still enter in. Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come and drink. Do you understand that the waters of life are for all? Who are those that deny themselves that for which they also thirst in soul? Who are those that deny themselves that which indeed will make them whole? Who are those that deny themselves the great power of infinite freedom to sit upon the throne, the three-in-one radiance of the eternal Godhead made manifest within the chalice of their own being? Let all come to that understanding then, where they can lay down their frustrations, their feelings of separation, and that which for far too long has kept them in a separate, unevolved, or unevolving state. We are concerned with the evolvement of mankind. We are concerned with those cosmic initiations that will cause men to rise in consciousness and not remain wedded to the same old decaying concepts, which are in many cases the breaking up of crystals which are not of the light. For the crystallization of various activities within mankind has created that hardness of heart and hardness of being which prevents the manifestation within them of the divine image. We come to you tonight with that sternness in our being, which means that those of you who profess that you would continue upon the spiritual path, finding the great tree of life that is in the midst of the garden, should also recognize the dynamic role which you ought to play as you accept the garments of God as your own. Mankind have no right to be untrue to this presence of God that is so true to them. They have no right to be faithless when God has invested so much of faith in them. The perfection of our presence, the indwelling radiance in the human tents, is encamped around about those that fear him from all generations unto this present one. O mankind, as there is a great gathering together of the family of nations, as there is a great gathering together and a kindling of the hearts of people, will you recognize your own role in supporting the light expansion in the domain of mankind? Understand how many are gathered together in the marts of commerce, in the theaters of entertainment, and in the world. Will you understand how many strange images are being flashed to mankind upon the television screens of the world? And will you understand at last, O blessed humanity, how the great teachings of the ascended masters ought to also vie with them and create in those who still thirst for righteousness, who hunger for righteousness, the desire that they should be full? For who has brought you here in the name of God? Why are you here? Why were you brought before us? Save that you might find your place in the immortal realms. You were not brought here for simply a little entertainment this evening. You were brought here that you might understand that measure of your cosmic devotion that will kindle the God flame within your own heart and mind, that you may function as a divine emissary in the realm of form to carry that God flame unto your fellow men. For when we speak of breaking the bread, we mean just that, that each crumb of the loaf of heaven should be carried thither and yon as by the wind of the Holy Spirit until those to the uttermost parts of the earth are able at last to enter in to our kingdom. For the kingdom of God is for those of the north, the east, the west, and the south. And the flame of God comes from the land of the north. And yet, as the lightning cometh from the east and goeth unto the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Let the light then from the east arise in your heart. Let the dawn of cosmic truth speak to you as never before. And understand with what measure of devotion you give unto the Eternal One, you shall also receive from his own hand. Mankind come with a farthing and leave with a farthing. When they come with the allness of their being, they find the great cosmic kindling within every cell, the multiplicity of the flame of life in every cell, the enervement of mankind with that great cosmic verve, which brings them awareness and the cosmic stimulation, which we desire to see played upon you tonight, because we flash forth our flame in your midst. If we step up the vibratory action in these rooms, will you permit it? Will you consent to it? We ask you in the name of heaven, for by your answer we shall determine the great level of our expansiveness in your midst. We will give you an outpouring of the cosmic love of God that we invoke for you now. All of you who consent, we invoke it, and we say, let it be done. O cosmic angels of the sacred fire, gather then from every corner of the universe those blessings which compose a cosmic cornucopia, a release of our infinite love in the name of God, that shall enthuse mankind with the reality of God and see that he no longer gropes in blindness for the great cosmic hand that reaches through the dark, that commands his life, his virtue, and his cosmic strength to arise. We say, arise in the God flame and recognize who you are. Recognize the staunchness of your ability to defend the cosmic law with every drop of your life which is within you. For the cosmic law is an essence white, an essence bright, an essence clean, an essence pure. It comes to view and makes secure the God in man that makes him pure. We ask you then, in the mighty name of the eternal presence, to receive our blessing and to understand that it shall always continue each day of your life and forever as you enter into that realm of praise to your own mighty I Am God presence, and will call unto your Christ self and unto me, Maitreya, that you might receive the blessing of the light made manifest now and forever through you, who become the tabernacles of witness, the tabernacles of grace, an oasis in the desert of humankind, to whom is given a white stone within your heart, the flame of life that does impart grace for every problem, strength for every weakness, beauty for all human ugliness, and the finality of the grace of security in the foreverness of infinity. I, Maitreya, have spoken, and out of the light have I sent forth more light. It is your light I have used, the light of your God presence. Will you receive it and be free? Its own God flame. When the magnificent winds of the Holy Spirit blow, the winds of devotion into the hidden and subtle chambers of the heart, then can man be made to feel the reality of selfhood and the kindness which he feels for his fellow men becomes the motivation of the divine flame within. A caress, a tenderness he has not known before. For the artificial charades, man has builded as a wall around himself, must be torn down and be no more. Yet the protective influences of the aura of the Holy Spirit will stand guard against the intrusion of all darkness from outer sources, enabling each one to clean and purify his world from an inward standpoint until he stands immaculate in the eyes of God. And what a wonder to see a man or a woman clothed upon with the gift of the sun, the fragrance of field and forest, the light of 10,000 suns blazing in the light of the eye of such a one. And what shall I say of the heart that is molded by fire? What shall I say of the celestial tones which infuse the very bones of that one with the melody of far-off worlds? The devotion that drew us as a mighty magnet toward Bethlehem. The light of the star, the joy that filled our being as apprehensive hope was most real, those moments upon the desert sands long ago. Yet our journey was the fulfillment of the most magnificent outpouring of cosmic understanding of the stars that was unraveled to our hearts and our minds and infused us with a subtle inward fire whose currents drew us as an unerring magnet to the light of his nativity. And why do I speak of nativity in this day, if it is not to engender men toward greater measures of kindness to others? For out of the milk of human kindness, entwined round about with the heart of the Divine One, is found the fruition of grace appearing in the individual monadic expression. A grace that floods us, as it does you, with the essence of the hopes of God for the world. Hopes that speak to those of every nation and of every dignity and indignity, for man has suffered much. Of those hopes that were long ago aborning within the heart of God, which men have carelessly trampled upon because they have not understood them. I am Dwalku, and my heart comes to you bearing the tides of pure love, but not as some men might qualify love, but as God has originally qualified love. A love that bends the bow of effort to create a clean, a new, and a beautiful heart where God first placed a beautiful heart. For there is an individualized expression in the hearts of all, the potential for this beautiful heart, which God has made many times and placed it within the grasp of individual parts of life, only to find that individuals would in the darkness of ignorance, refuse to see, refuse to perceive the nature of heaven's nearness to each one. Benevolence is from the sky. Benevolence is the life of the living one. In the name of your own mighty I Am presence is to be found an answer to each prayer silently breathed within the corridors of the mind. For each of you have secret ambitions, secret desires, which you have not even voiced unto yourself, because you have not known them. For they are secret and sacrosanct, even to the outer mind of the individual. These are whispers heard within the soul, echoes from that realm beyond the knowledge of the outer self. These manifest as longings, an outreach that desires to touch the face of God, to touch the star-like radiance that is in the heavens. For they are ever telling each man and each woman, I am omnipresent here. And the outreach of the little spark of the mortal being of man is to ultimately make contact with this masterful presence of truth in the universe. To make each one to feel that he is kin to the giant outlines of the macrocosmic deeds of God. These deeds from higher realms come also into the lower realm of outer form, and they make contact with man where he is, and they teach of the essence of Christ's purity and Christ's truth. Will you then bow your hearts and your minds in cosmic reverence to the great devotional outpouring of the angelic host that came with me? They are here, silent witnesses to the grandeur of the cosmic intent for each of you. And out of the fragrance of their mind, and out of the great pinions of devotion that are able to become energized on the instant, I bring to you this night, in the name of the living God, the renewal of that hope and that eternal covenant, which is the covenant of the ages. The wisdom of God that has been spoken in a whisper is that which thunders from the mountain of being, speaking of the lightning flash, the glimmer of the love of God, which transforms. In the silent vault where lay the body of the great Master Jesus, those of us who breathed the starry radiance of God upon the filament of his being, as the ritual of the brotherhood infused his life through the God intent in us all, watched as there came the first tender stirrings of immortality, bringing into the flame of the resurrection the outer manifestation of his body and restoring it to life and wholeness, that once again that heart that was still would renew the heartbeat of selfhood, nevermore to cease in the foreverness of God. For the foreverness of God has willed it so, and for each of you, that one day the cosmic thread, the antakarana of immortality, should come to you as the elixir of life, and restore you to that former state which you once knew when the flaming spirit of man danced in the presence of the sea of cosmic fire that was the immortals, whose flaming desire was a reality, infusing all things in their beginnings. Now comes the present moment when man, caught in the net and the traps, the delusions of his own spinning and creation, finds himself momentarily bereft of all reasoning pertaining to the divine, and in the callousness and carelessness of his mortal carnal mind, allows himself to be tethered to all sorts of delusions and blindness, to all manifestations of fear and doubt. We bring the tides of welcome. The brotherhood awaits. The brotherhood awaits the awakening of he who sleeps, who does not understand that which is in the cup of life, of immortal destiny, intended to resurrect in all the passions of the God design, that will make him determine above all to let go of those qualities of selfhood that he has not actually taken mastery over, and surrendering himself unto God, say, "Thy will be done," as the infusing flame of God blows upon the coal of identity with the sacred radiance of the Spirit, kindling anew upon the altar of identity that selfhood which then comes to a full blaze. And as man gazes upon this radiance, a pillar of fire in the wilderness of being, he sees upon the burning sands of life the record of God's intended graciousness. He understands the meaning of grace, and in the quickening of that moment of understanding, his life at last sets him apace with others who have gone before. You who dwell in the mortal tents, fold your tents but gently, and understand that the billowing winds of the Holy Spirit will open them once again. For it is the Father's intent, it is the Father's plan, that each spirit spark, each son and daughter of immortality, shall come at last into that sense of eternal resurrection where no quality is impossible unto them. For no quality of manifestation is impossible unto God. God is able to raise you up, to kindle in your mind, even in the darkened corners and recesses thereof, the fruit of the quickening life. And as I am come to you this night, it is with awareness of the cosmic needs for transmutation in your midst. And so, as we step up the quality of the divine heat to whiten mankind unto virtue, remember that by a little physical suffering, great peace is born, and the nature of man's identity becomes more beautiful as he is shorn of that which is truly a crown of thorns. Man has plaited for himself delusion and a sense of false grandeur. We substitute for it the realities of God, the true grandeur of the divine nature. And this substitution in reality is not a substitution, but a restoration of the divine nature unto all. I am Dwalku. Out of the wisdom of the East, I have spoken unto you. Out of the wisdom from the East that flashes as the lightning around the world, we kindle in all hearts a new desire, a desire for a quickening, a desire for an awakening, a desire for the awakening of virtues that are not even recognized, for man has not defined them as yet. But heaven, in its greater wisdom, has already defined them and brought them into that inward fruition whereby each individual life stream may be able to receive and to drink in the ineffable light of 10,000 suns. That each one be kindled then with the flame from the altars of heaven is our prayer. If we quicken you this night, will you forgive us? For our quickening is in response to your attendance in this place, to your coming, for we have believed and have accepted that you have appeared here because of the subtle hope that shines in your heart. A hope toward newness of life, a hope toward greater beauty, a hope toward greater happiness. And the whole world waits for the kindling in you of this grace of God. With bated breath, the whole universe stands awaiting a greater resurgence of the body of God upon earth. Why will you not begin right here, those of you who are here, to understand that the measure of our devotion that rendered us at last ascended beings is also the measure of your devotion, if you will it so. Will you then, with me tonight, allow yourself to become the recipient of this great tide of infinite grace? It is not myself alone. It is the self of the universe. It is the heartbeat of immortality that is a moving tide, regenerate and wondrous, flooding forth within the cup of your identity, coming almost as a silent knocker upon the door of life. Yet you hear the throbbing of the presence of the living God. Will you receive this omnipotent presence? Will you receive this grace? Will you receive this awareness? I have brought you this gift this night, for this is in a way your natal day. The day of your divinity is at hand. The day of your quickening. The day of your response to the omniscience of the Holy Spirit. To the beauty that has prepared itself within you through the ages that you were forming. Now is the moment. Will you grasp it or let it pass? It is up to each of you. I can be a bearer of the gift in the name of the living Christ. You can, if you will, receive it, for upon you is lavished God's love this night. And wherever these words are spoken, the love of God shall be increased. For his love is with you always, even unto the end of the ages. I, Dwalkul, seal you in the Christic is done. Thank you.
the Christ light, descend into the force field of man's conscious awareness. Let him become free at last from preconceived notions, from all that is not of the untrammeled light of the universal Christ. We have seen through the centuries how that the activity of the carnal mind is indeed one of enclosure, frustrating the internal radiance of the soul and closing out what might be called the draft of the light's energy, the breath of purity, whose onrush is needed in order to produce the clean burning flame of the living God, that as lamps in the eternal heavens show each individual how he may hope from day to day to eventually be a star in the sky of God, a reflector of immortal light and immortal love, one whose whole being is dedicated to the perfection of the divine intent in all that he does. Coming to you today is an experience in delight, and a delightful knowing that the I Am presence within each of you is sufficient unto each day, able to bring you those new experiences in spiritual understanding that will open those heavenly and cosmic doorways to you, that like Jacob of old, you also may dream and yet awaken from a dream, beholding the stairways to heavenly realms that you also may climb. Let not your feet falter upon the stairs, for eternal safety is builded into the ascent if man will only understand. Yet those moments of initiation and test that come to all are actually to refine your experiences, your expression, and give you the ability to reach out a hand to others who may be below you on the spiritual path in the sense that they come after you. We want you to understand that in the eternal now is total attainment. In the eternal now is total victory. Yet men dwell in the realm of where they are, caught as they are in the net of human delusion. Confusions tear their mind from the beauty of God and inaugurate a veil between the face of God and the being of man, his heart, the heart of his understanding. I come to you then this day that I may remove that portion of the veil permitted by cosmic law, that I may remove from your consciousness those cobwebs of human dust and replace it by the love and radiance of eternal destiny. Fresh from the hand of God, each day there is born in you newness of life, the distillation of the fragrances and the distillation of the energies of the angels. Through the acceptance of the never-failing light of God, all tired energies of mortal consciousness may vanish away, and the perfection of your presence leads you into that indomitable realm where there thunders forth those graces and tender outreaches that are the outreach of the hand of God and the love of God through the veil of flesh. I am Kathuni. I come to you this day to remind you also of your garment of light, a garment shining in its radiance that is spiritual, a garment of recognition of the Christ within you. It is I, be of good cheer. Through the concepts of the recognition of the realities of God, you will break eventually your connection with the carnal mind, and you will come to that place in your spiritual development, blessed ones, where at last there is no confusion, but only a clear seeing through all of the realm of the day and the realm of the night, and an understanding that at last, ultimately, there will be no night in your consciousness, but only the all clear seeing that enables you to hold that faith which conveys to worlds without end the miracle reality of your I Am presence, the tenderness of God's care and consideration for each of you. We are not concerned with mortal opinions, for they vanish away. We are concerned only with the light that is just beyond the veil, the light that is real and tangible, the light that is vital, the light that enables the Christ to come alive in your hearts and beings, tenderly unfolding his reality for you, each and every one, and for all mankind, that they may bear his light to the family of nations is our hope. That people all around the world will come to understand and recognize the eternal mission as identifiable with their own mission. That men will not think in separate realms, but in the unity of spiritual oneness. Yet there is a variety of expression that surges through all of life. For men and women do not always have the same specific mission. One star differeth from another star in brightness and glory. Even so is the resurrection from the dead. Blessed are they who believe and have not seen. Do you understand, blessed ones, how you long at times to tear the total veil from all obscurity and to behold with your own eyes even now? Let me tell you that in many cases it would be a great problem. For if this were to occur quite suddenly, you might find yourself literally bereft of soul and of consciousness. For you need the specific period of development you now have. You need that period in order to mature and to grow up in the Christ consciousness, to receive the unfolding love, the miracle love of God, that it may wrought change in your own inner nature. If you were to see the face of God in its total aspect now, there are some who would simply vanish away, for they have not externalized enough of God's grace within themselves. They have not drawn upon the magnetism of the universal law. They have not developed the latent image to that degree where they can safely trust the development of that image, to retain for them the vestiges of selfhood which God has intended and does intend from the beginning to manifest in all. Be patient in your search. Have love and understanding, and you will behold how at last all things that are of darkness will melt away as the coming dawn of Christ awareness floods you with his ineffable light. Out of the east, like the lightning, will come your awareness. You need not fear, for his words spoken of old, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I," are the words of the miracle consciousness of the resurrection. The resurrection in you of all good works, of all justice, of all correct sense, of cosmic grace. You need not become involved in all dogma as though you were the greatest theologian that had ever lived. For those who have a heart that reaches out in good faith to take unto themselves grace, these are they who understand all mysteries and all knowledge. Yet if you were to have all mysteries and all knowledge complete in your understanding today and did not possess the charity and eternal love of the grace of God that you now so lovingly seek, you would indeed be as a bar struck without melodic sound. We want you to understand then the need for patience and grace and devotion. Do not condemn yourselves. When you have erred, beloved ones, see that your high resolve is strengthened, that you will not again err. For through the grace of God, little by little, those stairways to your cosmic attainment will be climbed, and at last you too will find yourselves in the arms of perfect love, even as you now are already in those arms, but many times do not know it. O blessed ones, be faithful in all things, that you may become a ruler over all things. Do you understand what this means? It means the acceptance in your consciousness of total faith, total knowing, even although you may not always at each moment be able to speak it. For if there dwells in your heart that infinite love, that infinite love is all consuming. It is able to consume the dross and the pain and the stigmas of the world and lead you into the paths of true righteousness for his name's sake. What is profundity if it is not the miracle of simplicity? Let me warn you, one and all, not to become enmeshed always in those intricate situations that can cause a man to spoil his own soul. Be satisfied to be childlike in your faith and awareness, knowing that God will give you the greatest and most profound understanding and the power to reach out your hand and command substance and life that it obey you. The power to rule the winds and the waves was in his hand. And when he gave it unto me, at first I did not understand. Little by little, his grace came through, infusing my soul and bringing to view the newness of heaven, the newness of life. This is the answer that ends all strife.
I am hope, born by the summer wind of God's immortal love, I come with a gesture to each soul of the tender moment of his own unfolding reality. One day, each heart who yearns for the glory of God in the highest to dwell bodily within him will be able to express that budding hope, which will then flower majestically, symbolically, actually, and in that degree of cosmic finality, which melodiously and spiritually makes him victor over all the darkness of the past days, flooding him at last with the ineffable light of the morning of hope, the morning when the darkness is forever past. For there shall be no night there. Let men and women learn to dwell in my arms, in the arms of hope. For my consciousness is a chalice of sunbeams, radiantly fired together with the fires of myriad cosmic suns, a blending of strength and a forgetting of those things which are behind, as men and women learn to look ahead to the fountainhood of cosmic strength gushing up from the orifice of the heart and the nodules of the threefold flame that is ablaze there. Will you then, beloved ones, in the mightiest name under heaven, the true Christic name of being, I am, recognize how you may claim for yourself the authority over all human density and all mortal conditions of despair, assuming at last the true vestments of your cosmic identity and that spirit of consecrated rightness, whereby you assert at last your dominion over all the darkness that has ever held sway in your own outer field of consciousness. For your God presence is the authority for your life. It is the authority for your love. It is the authority for your wisdom. When you feel lacking in any of these components of universal righteousness, invoke from the heart of God in my name, if you will, or in the full authority of your own I Am presence. It does not matter whichever name you may use in reality, for I am a consecrated portion of the authority of your own I Am presence. I have given myself joyously, affirmatively, willingly, and devotedly to the presence of God in all portions of life, that I may bring that infinite measure of divine and universal cosmic hope into the force field of embodied humanity, that they will not succumb to those spirits of the night that continually give voice to hopelessness. For hopelessness is indeed a vacuum, a creature of darkness that moves toward destructivity with no ability to restore, no ability to exalt, no ability to inspire or inspire mankind. Will you then accept the native creations
of your true God identity, and be an outpost of cosmic hope wherever you are. Have you ever thought for a moment that our authority and presence is capable of indefinite multiplication? We are able to expand and expand and expand our consciousness through each and every one who is receptive to the opportunity in daily living that expresses, as God intended, those fragments of universal hope that, like the sacred Eucharist, speak of those infusing moments of cosmic identity when God, through the authority of his presence, is infusing each of you with the very marvelous manifestations of your true cosmic identity. I speak in the daffodils. I speak in the lilies. I speak in a rose of any color. I speak everywhere throughout nature in the constancy of the universal pine with its tall, pointed wand that speaks of a height yet to come. I am hope. I give birth in the consciousness of man to that faith that will magnetize to him those God-intended resurrection consciousnesses, and that resurrection consciousness which is out of the universal fountain of oneness. You are many in effect, and yet you are one. And in this concept is also greater hope in its fullest measure. You are not really fragmented, but rather fragmented to come together, to be glorified, to be lifted up. And I, if I be lifted up, will draw all men unto me, said the Master, emphasizing the radiance of the universal Eucharist, lifted up in the wilderness of man's affliction and his abominations, to the forgetting of all that is dark and unclean, and the raising of his being into the folds of cosmic Christ identity, that he, in the name of hope, in the name of charity, in the name of faith, may weld together the fractional units of himself into one monadic spiritual expression of true hope. The resurrection from the dead will soon be celebrated by many upon the planetary body, but only the indwelling presence of the universal resurrection, each day of the year and each eternal moment, is truly a caressing of accomplishment. How magnificent is the glory of God to be perceived even in the outer face of nature. But when you are able to open your eyes and to have that inner vision that will enable you to see the tiny elementals in all of their magnificent and glorious, sometimes even blessed ones, amusing capers, you will recognize at last that there is a smile upon the face of the universe, that there is a smile of joy within the chalice of your hearts, that out of the domain of hope, man may call forth for himself and every part of life those strengths of the spirit which do strengthen the bonds of cosmic hope upon the planetary body. Out of the depth of light and love and true faith comes forth a greater measure of the abundance of joy. To him that hath shall more be added,
to him that hath not shall be taken away that which he hath. I praise the moment when each of you will be the former, to whom will be added the joys of the Lord, the accomplishments that are the true enduring accomplishments of strength to the world. Not a strengthening of the shafts of militant darkness in the world, but a strengthening of the joys of Christ unity that will bring mankind into the refreshing moments when the latter rain of cosmic joy will pour upon multitudes of hearts, refreshing them as never before with the radiance of the living God. The latter rain, as tears of joy from the heart of God, will assure at last the whole human race that never again shall moments of fear and doubt and distrust fill the world, but only moments of consecrated endurance, the vitality of eternity that speaks to mankind through the joys of the flowers and the fields themselves, rich unto the harvest of the potential now manifest in the springtime of the golden age, when while the remnants of the shadows of darkness are still with man because of his former sowings, the beginnings of light are radiantly pouring forth, and hope as a rising sun over the harvest fields, over all the fields of man's seasons, speaks at last of a joy to come in the fruition of that victory which I am, the fruition of that victory which you are, and the reality of a hope that bubbles in the cup of life as a refreshing spring, never again to allow mankind to sink into that oblivion of consciousness that has and holds fear as its own, but in its place exalts the power of hope to lift the wings of the mind and to be lifted by them into that heaven radiance of white light and immortal love in which dwells the consciousness of the immortals. We are they who offer ourselves to you this day in your service and in the service of the brotherhood, that mankind may know at last in the certainty of their being that joy without end is to be found in the fruit of hope, which abides with you, which may be invoked by you, which may be called forth in moments of despair. For greater love hath no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friend. Those of us in the higher realms are doing just that. We are laying down our spiritual treasures to you upon earth, who are our friends. The fruit of the Spirit is yours for the asking. Ask and ye shall receive, but abide in that indwelling faith of universal accomplishment. You are the children of God. As you sow, so shall you reap. And as you sow the bountiful seed of faith, hope, and charity, these three, agreeing in one before God, shall perform the work of the Lord in this day of the latter rain, the day of the reign of the eternal God, refreshing and being refreshed by the great paeans of praise and adoration which are offered to him from those hearts that are the redeemed of the earth. I am hope, and I remain hope forever in your heart, in your mind, and in the joy of your tongue. For in the telling of all that God has done is a greater joy than you yet know. Be open, be blessed, be cherished, be consecrated. Above all, be hope.